Welcome everyone to my talk. It's OSC, what's new and best practices. Not to get you confused, it's not about the OpenSUSE conference, it's about a command line tool for the open build service. About me, a few words just. I'm a build service engineer at SUSE. I'm OSC maintainer since this year. I'm contributing to OSC since December 2016. I'm a father, chaos navigator, and organizer, time management specialist, all that I can do. About the agenda and what will happen here in this room is that I will tell you about the news of OSC, which is quite difficult because I have never given this talk before, so I just picked one date, and it's the beginning of 2017, and started at this point for my what's news. After that, we will see a best practice. It's really low level if you know OSC and the build server in detail. This could be a little bit boring, so just grab a drink or relax. After that, I will tell a little bit about the Python 3 status. So we are trying to port the OSC to Python 3, and I will tell you how far we are and what needs to be done and how you can help with us with that. Then the next thing is plugins. There is a special thing about that, but we will see. And then I will talk a little bit about the future. I just realized that I got a 45-minute spot. That's not what I wanted. I just clicked wrong. So this will not last 45 minutes. It will, perhaps we will hit the 30 minutes, but yeah, we will see. So what's new? Big news, we support IPv6. Yeah. Then we improve the build recipe guessing. I don't know if you are familiar with that. If you just issue an OSC build, the script does not know what you want to build if you have more than just one build recipe and just one more repository or architecture. So we built a neat algorithm which tries to detect what you want to build. It's not perfect, but it's a start. Then we have a new OSC blame command. It's like git blame. So it's just issue OSC blame and you see who has done changes to the files. Then we have generic build options which can be passed to the build script. We have Docker builds now. There are a few workshops of Docker builds, I think, done this conference. We now show the build duration in the build history. That's not big stuff, but a lot of small stuff. The config file of OSC is now in the right place. If you have noticed, if you install a new OSC, the config file is not in the home directory anymore. In the plain home directory, it's now under the config file folder. And we have an OSC RPM lint log, so you can just look at the RPM lint log from the OSC command line client. We try to improve the change root command of OSC, so we now mount file system which are important, like dev or pds and such. We have a SHA-256 checksum verification, which makes it even harder to sneak something into the build service that you don't want to have there. And weak dependencies are now supported in the local builds. And we can even send sys requirements to the running builds. We are now able to diff meta files. And we had some problems with SSL when the complete client got stuck and nothing was done anymore. So this is also fixed by now. It was actually fixed like 1 week ago. We also have interactive request mode. It's when you are a reviewer, and you have to deal with a lot of requests. You can go through them in the interactive request mode. I don't know. Does anyone know what a request is? Okay, cool. We have one that knows it. I will just explain it. If you have a new package and you want to get it into Tumbleweed or some devil project, you start in your home directory and then you create a submit request into the specified project. And with the interactive review mode, a reviewer can just issue the command and gets all requests that are important for him and can go through the list one after the after another and can look at the build status, can look at the lint log, can look at the diffs and all that is there. So just it's just an easy way to have requests done. Then I listed the releases since 2017. There are a few. This is just for an overview what have been done since then. Yeah, the best practice is I will just show you how you can start a project and a package on your own and bring it into the build service with the OSC command line client. I don't have anything against the web interface. The web interface is very nice and it's really, really good. But sometimes I just want to do it on the command line for reasons. And for this, I created an example source for the package. And because I'm a very good developer, I just used a simple C Hello World program, which you can find under this GitHub link. It's a very simple program. And I created a project for this package. It's basically my home project. It's home mstriegel. You can look at it and see what I have done and see what the result of this all is. So there are basically two ways you can use to create a new package. You can issue the OSC meta minus E, which stands for edit. And say, okay, I want to edit the metadata of a package, and you just add the package name. And if this package is not there yet, it gets created as soon as you enter the basic information like the title and the description. Those can both be empty, but the text must be there. So you cannot just leave it blank. The title and the description text must be there, but they can be empty. So after this gets transmitted to the server. The server creates the package directory and everything is fine. The next way is to use OSC mkpack, hello OSC, which does basically the same, but on the client side at first. So the big difference between these two is that if you issue the one with the meta, you have to check out the package after that. So you don't have a working copy automatically generated on your system. That's the big difference between these two. And then to get a starting point, you need a spec file. So I just created a simple spec file with all the information that is needed, like, okay, the name, the version, the release, the license, and all what RPM needs to build a nice package. I have a prep section, a description, and everything that is needed. As I said, it's a very basic example. So how do I get the sources that I want to build? One way is to use service files. I choose this option because I find it pretty neat to get it out of GitHub automatically and to don't have to deal with tarballs and that things, and to download the tarball and upload it to the build service. So I just used a service file. For the service file, this is the basic anatomy of a service file. You have the service tag, then you have the service name you can issue. There are a lot of services. At the end of the presentation, I have links to all relevant documentation of services and all that I will present here. So I will not go to every detail and explain what this line does and this line does that. I will just give you a basic concept. So the service name obs-scm will get the file from GitHub, and then there will be some magic, and in the end you have something that can be processed. So it gets source code downloaded as an OBS CPIO archive. That's just a format we use for downloading the sources. And then it gets archived as a tar, compressed as a gzip, and then the modified spec file is written with the version number replaced in the right place. So now we have everything. So this is just a local run. So if it's OC service run, you can test it. It will check out locally, but it has nothing to do with the actual build. It's just to see that the service file is correct and that it will download the right sources and that everything is fine. Now we have everything we need. We have the service file, we have the spec file, and now we can check with OC repos which repositories are valid for my package or my project in which I can build. Then I can do an OSC build with the repository and the architecture and the recipe. The recipe is the spec file. And in our case, that would be OSC build, OpenSUSE factory, because we want to build for the newest shiny system. And the architecture is x86-64. And the spec file. And then it starts a local build, and you can see, okay, if it builds, it's everything fine. If not, you can just look at what happens, what is wrong, and what needs to be done. A few words about meta information. Meta information are used to control the build and the package, and to store information about the build, the package, or the build environment, or the project. So everything can be stored in a meta information. If you do OSC repos, I get for my home project, I have all those repositories and architectures I can build against. So if I take my little greeter, it will be built for all those repositories and architectures, but I don't want to. I just want to build for a few of them. So the way to go is to disable some builds on the package level. To do this, you can edit the package meta information and say, okay, I have all these repositories. I just disable the complete architecture. I don't want to build for the ARM7L architecture. I don't want to build for the architecture ARC64. I don't want to build for i586. And I don't want to build for anything other than OpenSUSE. So I do this with the OSC meta minus e for edit package hello OSC. And then I type this, and magically some magic happens, and in the end I just got the repositories I want to build for, which is basically OpenSUSE with the x86-64 architecture. So this is what happens then. this is just a small overview about what configs are there. There's the project conf, which defines the build environment. You can say, okay, I don't want to use a specific package for my build. I want another version of the package, which is not defined in the repository. So I can use the project config to handle how the build environment is built, can even add additional repositories or additional packages here. And there is a very good description in our wiki, which I put here in the presentation. So if you are interested in meta information, you can just look at this link. Then the package we already seen that defines the package. And the basic most simple way, it's just the package name, the package title, and a package description. The same we have for the project, like a project name, project title, and a project definition, description. So, but there are a lot of good sources where you can look up this, and you can look this up. So, now we have everything we need. We have a local build that is okay. It builds for all repositories we want. We have the services file. Everything is fine at this point. There is some thing that is called a change log. Some people like to document their changes. Some people don't like to document their changes. But it's in most cases, it's a better way to go that you document what you have done and when you have done it and why you have done it. Because it's when sometimes, let's say you get ill, I don't know, if I trip over the steps there and break my leg and I can't go to work, and somebody has to understand why I did some changes to a package, it's pretty hard. So there's a change log where you can describe what you have done. OSC even provides a way where you can create a change log pretty simple and complete automatic. It's just OSC VC. Then an editor opens and you can type whatever you want. It even provides the date, the time, and your name and your email. So everything will be fine. Just type what you have done and write it, save it, and you have a changes file. To check what, so this is just locally in your local working copy. Nothing here happens actually on the server at this point. You see it if you issue an OSC status, you see that they are all marked with the question mark, which means that are not under a version control yet. So you have to add them. If you want just to add them all, you just can say, okay, OSC add asterisk, and all new files are added automatically. And after that, they get the status A. And there are just a few statuses here, like added, which basically means, okay, it's a new file I want to upload. Conflicted is when there are changes upstream made, and you need to change, and you have changes in the same file, and then you do an update of your working copy, then you can get into the conflicted state. The deleted state is also you have to deleted it locally. And yeah, I think the statuses are all self-explanatory. So is this, at this point, we are even not on the server yet. So we are just locally. Even now we are not on the server. This is the command which does the last step and says, okay, put it all onto the build service and let's get it out. It's the OSC CI. It contains the diff, what you have done. It contains the files, what you want to upload or to delete, and and the description. The comment you have there is you can choose whatever you want. And after that, this one gets upload it to the build service, and the build service, if everything is right and everything is configured properly in your project, the package will start building on the build service. Of course, you have to save it before everything happens, and then it gets transmitted. It gets the revision number one if it's the first upload, and we are done at this point, and the file is uploaded, and everything is fine. Just to give you an example what the build service can do and how you can control it with OSC, I've chosen just one random feature, which is constraints. Constraints are a way to control the build server and say, okay, I need more build power, more power. And it can be done on many different ways. You can, I've chosen here to say, okay, I need 500 gigabyte of space to build my Hello World program. Huh? So I get really, really good power. This will of course not work because we don't have any workers with this amount of disk space. It's just ridiculous. So this will fail, it will not build. So we can check our constraints with OSC check constraints and the repository and the architecture. We can check, okay, how many workers will be able to build this, or am I using here constraints that are not even realistic anymore? So I can check, okay, my constraints are okay, which in the 500 gigabyte case will of course not. And if I issue it without any repository or architecture, it will print me for all repositories or architectures the number of workers that are able to build my package. So, but in this case, I lowered it a little bit to I think 50 gigabytes, so we have 25 workers with 50 gigabyte. So, yeah, and the build service doesn't let you in the dark when you build the package and it finds no worker which can build it. You get the message, no compliant workers. And it even gives you a hint which of your constraints are too scary for the system or too big or whatever. So it says here, okay, you wanted to have 500 gigabyte of hard disk? No. There is a link where you can learn about constraints. It's a good tool to control the build service and the workers you want to build on. Especially if you have a more complex package than just a Hello World. This is what I told in the news. We have a OSC blame command. This is how it looks actually. I played a little bit around and was wondering why my build took so long. So I just issued the OSC blame and see, oh, there's a sleep 600. And now I can see, okay, someone named Leslie L, that's, I don't know who this guy is, put the sleep 600 in, and now I can go to him and say, hey, put it out. And the OSC has a few ways to investigate a package. It's you have an OSC info which provides you the basic information about your working copy. It's basically just what revision you have, what directory you are in, the link in the OBS you can look at it in the web UI. Then you have the OSC log command, which gives you for every check-in you see who checked in, what time, then the source MD5, and with what message it was checked in. And we have even more. We have a build history where you we have two things here. We have a job history and a build history. That's a little bit confusing for people using OSC the first time, because build history is, in the build history, they are just succeeded builds. If you want to see builds that are also failed or for some reason got interrupted or whatever, you have to use job history, because you won't see failed builds in the build history. And here you see the time, the source MD5, the version number, the revision number, the duration, how long it took. And here you see my build with the Sleep 600. It took 708 seconds to build. And in the job history, you see also the failed ones. And there you see, okay, the build started at 1427, failed, and the one who is telling this is the dispatcher. And the dispatcher is the one that gives it to the workers. And so you can, it's possible a hint that there is something wrong with your constraints, which was, in this case, the truth. Then you have the OSC results. The results show you what the build service, what the build service is doing. In this case, for OpenSUSE Leap 42.3, it's still building, and it even tells you if you issue it with a verbosity switch, on which worker it is building, then you see which repositories are disabled. And if it's done building on a server and you want just to get the binaries to test it or to look into it, you can issue the OSC get binaries command and you get all the binaries, the RPM if you build for OpenSUSE, of course. Yeah. But you get a lot more than just the binaries. You get also the build environment definition, so you can look into the exactly build environment which was used for this build on the server. So you see, you can here debug some things. And you get a statistics file which contains how long it builds, how much load was created, and such things. And you get the RPM lint log. So that's just a small part of what is possible with the OSC. The OSC has in the moment 89 commands which you can issue, so it's pretty big. So to show every command here, it's too much. The next topic is taming the chaos. It's like, OSC is Python 2. And Python 2 will die sometimes, perhaps, we will see. And we are trying to be modern and to be ready, so we are porting to Python 3 at the moment. The challenges here were that it was written for Python 2.4, and it needs to stay compatible with every Python version, even 2.4. So I cannot just say, okay, we'll just use Python 3 everywhere and the other Python version doesn't interest me anymore. I have to be compatible with every Python version here. And the other problem is that we have a lot of tools and plugins that use the OSC core libraries, and I don't want the plugin developers to I don't want to cause more pain than needed. So I have to be sure that the behavior of the function is the same than before. Another big problem was that there is no Python 3 version of the URL grabber, which is a module which handles mirror downloading. You give the URL grabber a list of URLs and he tries every URL and the first hit wins. So, but this one doesn't exist in Python 3, so I had to implement my own module on this one. The URL open dot read now returns binary data instead of just text data, and we use this to get the information from the server. So all functions or processes that got run after this needs to be adapted. And a lot more pitfalls on the way. So the progress is, at the moment, we have a running Python 3 OSC branch. You see it here. The Python 3 compatible package can be installed besides your existing OSC installation, so there should be no problems with interfering config files or something. And there's documentation to be done of all this. So what you can do to help me here is use the Python 3 branch and report bugs in GitHub with the prefix Python 3 or email or whatever. I just need more people to test it, because we have so many commands. I said 89 commands with even more combination of switches and parameters and all that stuff. So yeah, testing is good, so please test. Plugins, let's here be plugins. The problem is that I finished this presentation yesterday, and I didn't have the time to finish this topic. So shame on me, but I don't have anything to say about plugins other than that there are plugins. Yeah, so I'm very sorry. So let's talk a little bit about the future of the OSC, what is planned. One big news, I'm planning a rewrite in Perl. No, of course not. My main task is to get it Python 3 compatible. That's my main focus here. And the password handling is enhanced at the moment, will be enhanced. There are two people working on this. At the moment, the passwords are stored in clear text. So this is not very good. They are in config files, which shouldn't be world readable and everything, but storing clear text passwords should not be done. So this is done at the moment, and there will be a lot of more improvements regarding the interactive mode I mentioned. And one big point is to preserve the local build environments when you use Docker or KVM builds, because at the moment you can just switch to old build environments when you're using change root builds, but not if you're using virtual machines or Docker builds. And of course, help and documentation needs improvement, of course. That's always needs improvement. And one thing that isn't on this in the slide, I just was made aware of this yesterday, is that testing OSC sucks. So we have unit tests which test the basic core lib functions. And if I would blindly rely on these unit tests, my Python 3 port would be done around 3 months ago, because I switched everything with the Python 2 to 3 command, and the test suite was running in Python 3, and I was like, yeah, I'm the biggest Python developer in the world. So, but then I started to using it, and it was, okay, perhaps not. So the testing needs improvement. And if you have any idea how to do testing, please talk to me. I have a basic idea how to do testing, but not in this complete framework. The end. The end is the end of my presentation. So thanks for your attention. I'm not ready yet. If you have questions, just email me. I'm on Freenode in the OpenSUSE Build Service channel. or just get in contact over the GitHub project. And as always, patches are always welcome. Contributions are always welcome. We're a great community. And thanks for your attention. Now you can clap. Yeah, and of course, all credits for the slides go to Richard Brown. Yeah. So if you have any questions, I will be, yes. Contact, of course. This one? Okay, cool. If you have any questions, I will be around here the next days, of course. Mostly you will find me in behind one of those video tables. And I cannot just go away from there, so if you want to talk to me or want to discuss something, just leave me a note and I will get back to you. Okay, so yeah, have fun at the rest of the conference and enjoy yourself.